Hello everyone, and welcome to a new episode from the Medical Bacteriology series. Today's episode will hopefully teach you all the general information you need to know about one of the most medically significant bacterial species, the Streptococcus pneumoniae. It is a gram-positive streptococci, so it takes some purple dye when gram-stained, and is present in the form of short chains or in pairs. That's why it's called gram-positive diplococci or pneumococcus. The cells of this bacteria are lancet-shaped, so they are not spherical but rather have sharp ends, and they're also characterized of being surrounded by a well-developed capsule. The strep pneumoniae are branched into 90 different types based on this antigenic capsule, which produces different types of genes, proteins, and toxins that vary from one serotype to another. And they can be differentiated by a special reaction called the capsular swelling antisera. The bacterial capsule also has an antiphagocytic function, which means that it can protect the bacterial cell from being engulfed by the white blood cells in the immune system, by covering all of the receptor sites from which the immune cells can recognize the bacteria. Like all other streptococci, the strep pneumoniae is a fastidious microorganism, so it can only grow on enriched media, and the best enriched media for all streptococci is the blood agar. The strep pneumoniae shows alpha haemolysis on the blood agar, which appears as greenish-gray colored area surrounding the colonies. And this occurs due to the streptococcal production of alpha haemolysin toxin, which transforms the hemoglobin to methemoglobin. The strep pneumoniae is present in the normal flora of the human upper respiratory tract, and it's usually non-pathogenic unless there is a previously existing viral infection like influenza, or any other infection in areas where the strep pneumoniae inhabits. That's why the strep pneumoniae is said to cause secondary infections, because it cannot cause infections on its own, but it can still cause direct infections in people with weak immunity like children, elders, alcoholics, people who have undergone splenectomy, and people with sickle cell anemia are more likely to be infected. And therefore, people with influenza are prescribed some other antibiotics to prevent the opportunistic bacteria from causing secondary infections. The strep pneumoniae causes several infections, most of which are in the respiratory tract, such as lobar pneumonia, bronchopneumonia, sinusitis, which can spread to the middle ear and cause otitis media, and conjunctivitis. If this bacteria entered the blood and released its toxins, it will cause septicemia, which in result will lead to meningitis and endocarditis. So that's why back in the 1900s, the strep pneumoniae was considered fatal until antibiotics were discovered and produced industrially. In addition to the polysaccharide capsule, the otolysin and neumolysin are considered to be strong virulence factors. The otolysis occurs through the production of peptidoglycan hydrolase, which breaks down the peptidoglycan in the bacterial cell wall. When it's being attacked by immune cells, the bacterial cell autolyses itself and releases all of the toxic substances in order to destroy the immune cell by releasing neumolysin, which destroys the plasma membrane of the host cells. And as for the practical work, the strep pneumoniae appears to be surrounded by a clear area, which is the capsule. Sometimes this capsule may not be well visible, and it can be detected by the Quillan swelling test. And that is by adding an antisera to the antigenic capsule, so they both unite, and this leads to the swelling of the capsule, which appears obviously under the microscope. All capsulated bacteria have a very unique appearance on the agar. The colonies look shiny and semi-solid with moist and mucoid texture. Like all other streptococci, the strep pneumoniae is catalase negative, and in contrast with the rest of the streptococci, the strep pneumoniae is inline fermenting. We can differentiate between the strep pneumoniae and the strep viridans, which is also alpha hemolytic, by the optogen sensitivity test. The strep pneumoniae is sensitive, while the strep viridans is resistant. Another differential test is the bile acid sensitivity test. The strep pneumoniae autolyses itself in the presence of antibiotics or any other unsuitable environmental condition, including the presence of bile acids. So the principle of the test is to inoculate strep pneumoniae into a tryptone broth media, which is liquid agar, then incubate it for 24 hours. The broth will show obvious turbidity due to the growth of the strep pneumoniae. The bile acid is added afterwards, and the broth is incubated for another 15 minutes. If the broth remained turbid, then the bacteria is resistant, such as strepharidins. If the broth turned clear, that indicates the death of the bacteria due to its sensitivity to the bile acids, such as the case of strep pneumoniae. As for the treatment, cell wall inhibitory antibiotics are required, such as penicillin, which has been quite effective until the 1980s, when scientists found out that the strep pneumoniae have developed resistance towards penicillin. But other beta-lactam antibiotics which target the peptidoglycan layer has shown a strong effect against the strep pneumoniae, such as the third generation of cephalosporins, but yet the best option so far is the vancomycin, because it's also effective against the penicillin-resistant strep pneumoniae strains. But we're not done yet, because there is also a vaccine for strep pneumoniae infections, and it's called the pneumococcal polysaccharide vaccine, introduced back in the 1983, and it's effective against 23 of the most widespread pathogenic serotypes of strep pneumoniae. The vaccine is given to children older than 2 years because they're more likely to get infected, and it has shown 85 to 90% of reliability and effectiveness. However, this vaccine isn't prescribed to children younger than 2 years, and their immune system will not respond to it, because the oligosaccharide would alter the immune response from the T cells directly to B cells. So children younger than 2 years are given the pneumococcal conjugate vaccine, which is also effective against 13 of the most pathogenic serotypes that infect newborn children. Now that we've got to the end of today's video, I hope it was helpful. Don't forget to like, share, and subscribe. Bye!